Hello and greetings from Iceland, but my name is Gilvi and I will be your guide today while we visit a small village with a little over 100 inhabitants. But don't think for a moment that it's gonna be a quiet little visit, since the village is situated on the plate boundaries where things have been and still are shaky. So welcome to the earthquake village Kópasker. As usual, we start the journey on a map, but the village is by the north coast, by a peninsula called the Melrakkasletta, or Arctic Fox Plain, and it is the northernmost part of Iceland, so let's zoom down and approach the town facing northeast and enjoy the late September autumn colors. The name of the village, Kópasker, derives from a baby seal pup and a skerry that was where the end of the pier is now. Kópasker became a certified trading post in 1880 and from there it would grow around the local co-op that was the heart and soul of this countryside for decades. The co-op serviced the farmers around and operated a store, a slaughterhouse and a freezing plant and literally took care of whatever business there was to do in the village. And the old co-ops were in a way like a state within the state during the 1900s, so towns would either survive or fall with them. And the long story of the local co-op was for the most part successful, but it would however end with a bankruptcy in 1990. So the local farmers got together and formed a new company called Fjallalamb or Mountain Lamb, and that was done to keep the slaughterhouse and the meat processing plant going in the village. And now, in September, is the season when they deposit the lambs and the sheep into that factory to be fully processed, ready for retail stores or sold directly to consumers. And they provide 60 seasonal jobs and 20 all year round jobs, which is a lot in a small community. And overall, here in Iceland, we see small towns like Kópasker deal with population decline, and it's not necessarily due to lack of jobs, but things have been relatively stable in this village for the last decade or so, and population decline is only noticeable in the rural areas surrounding the town. But this village did, however, never grow to be much larger than it is now. This was not one of the herring villages during those golden years that later would leave many towns and villages in ruins or when there was no herring left. And the closest that they came to such an adventure here was the shrimp industry. But the bay by the town was full of shrimp. And that became a big industry for a while during those times when up to 1,000 tons were caught annually in this bay alone. But like with the herring, overfishing was a major setback. Fishing was banned for years, but that worked out, so it's looking better now into the future. The shrimp is back, but this is not a fishery town as we usually define them, although there are some boats around and some fish processing, and a new fish farm is now under construction just by the town, so it is a growing industry around here and might be a stepping stone into a different future for the village. That is today, first and foremost, about to serve the local farmers. Like I could hear very well while flying the drone around, or the sound of metal coming from the machine shop where they were fixing a tractor. And when we take into account how small the village is, it offers a surprisingly high service level. Like the local store is doing a good job in the old co-op building, not just selling groceries, but fast food and coffee and such, using well every little corner of this micro-market, which is in fact the only way to survive as a shopkeeper around here. And shopkeepers in small places like this do play a major role when it comes to the living quality around, and of course make it worthwhile to do a stopover for coffee and such. And there is some tourism around here, but we are 7 hours away from Reykjavík and the international airport, or as far as we can possibly get away from the city. And we are not even by the official ring road around Iceland that I need to cover in a separate video, because it is a misleading concept as we present it today. Kópasker is of course by the ring road, but not as we have defined it since 1974. But we are, however, by the so-called Arctic Coastway, and it draws special attention to coastal towns like this. So it's of course possible to camp here, and some guest houses can be found as well. The village offers all the basic service that visitors need, but there is no swimming pool here though, and that's very rare in Icelandic village. But the next one is, however, only 20 minutes away. And when I look up Kópasker on TripAdvisor or what to do, it's not showing me many options at all. Again confirming how rural this village is and the low number of visitors that do a detour from the official ring road. But it's not as the local people aren't trying. A wool mill can be found nearby for those with interest in Icelandic wool, which is a very strong export product with fans all over the world. So to sell it straight from the farm like here with some local processing techniques is a great idea that I hope to grow. And a nearby museum presents a collection of handicrafts showing daily life in the 19th century around here. So despite the fact that TripAdvisor is presenting the village as kind of dull even, I want to mention a video I made about a small coastal village by the south coast, where 750 villagers get over 5,000 guests every day, and it's so saturated of tourism that it is hard to find anything that gives us an idea about local culture and history, and the wool sweaters that you buy in that town will most likely be made in China. But this town is as real as a town can be. What you see is what you get. And even the travel industry in Iceland tends to forget the value of such tourist options, or to experience everyday Icelandic norm without any pre-designed reality for tourists. But it is however obvious that there are some designers around, and I love to see people get so creative by the road, like this idea that presumably started as a practical scarecrow but developed into this very welcoming show, once again telling me that good ideas that make you wanna stop don't have to cost too much. And this does way more for me than a puffin replica made in China and sold everywhere. So this is my answer to that through my online store to support my work. But more about tourism. I look at Kópasker as a good idea for those who want to be practical when it comes to accommodation. And I did a short test on hotelsandbooking.com now in September 2022, and the prices around here were among the best you could find in a country. And as we get closer to the tourist hotspots, we will get back to the Icelandic norm when it comes to pricing. Or should we say abnormal norm? But what can we do from here? And the simple answer is plenty. And the short description of the region would be strong contrasts, not just in nature, but weather as well. To the north, we have the Arctic Fox Plain, and the northernmost part of Iceland, the best place to see the never setting sun during summer solstice. And it's also a good place to go after northern lights, but I have a long video about the northern light hunting online and linking to it. But solitude might be the best single word to describe that part of Iceland. And there is another small village on the north part of the peninsula called Riverhub. And through that town it is possible to do a round trip around the peninsula, partially on old seaside highway or gravel road. And there are many good fishing lakes around, way more trouts than tourists. But to the south from Kópasker, we are only 30 minutes away from Ásbyrgi, one of Iceland's most spectacular formations, carved out by a giant flood, and the campground there is known for good weather. But to the north, the weather can be as dull as it gets in Iceland, because we are very close by the Arctic Circle around here. And further south by the river that carved out this formation, we find Dettifoss waterfall. And it's not the nicest waterfall we have, but it is by far the most powerful waterfall in Iceland. And standing so close to it takes us, in a way, back to the formation of our volcanic island, shaped by fire, ice and water. And there are actually two roads by the glacial river The old one is to the east from the river, and from there you can see the waterfall from this angle and get very close. And the road there is substandard gravel road, but you can however go there on any car during summer. And at the other side of the river we have a new road. It's a road that's officially recommended to see the waterfall. And on that side of the river we have new tourist infrastructure, large car park, and easier access to the waterfall. But it's of course a matter of taste from where you will be shooting photos, from east or west. And both the roads leads us to the official ring road near Lake Mývatn, yet another must-see place in Iceland. And my point is that if you want to save some money, it might be a good idea to use Kópasker for cheaper accommodation than you find closer by the hotspots, or simply just to stay away from the mainstream. And those roads I've been talking about are by the plate boundaries. So the last chapter of this visit is all about them. And the large earthquake that struck in 1976 just by Kópasker. Luckily, there were no serious injuries, but it damaged most of the houses in the village and all roads around. But that earthquake was however just a part of a larger story, or rifting event on this 80 kilometer long section of the plate boundary. It stretched all the way from Kópasker and south to the volcano Krafla, which is a typical plate boundary volcano and looks like this. Notice also this explosion crater from the year 1724, but this blew up when the so-called Lake Mývatn fires were starting and went on for years. And that region can be seen here. But this geothermal power plant in front of us was under construction in 1975 when the rifting event started. And for a while it looked as it would never get into operation. 20 magma intrusions in total were detected back then, causing 9 eruptions between 1975 and 1984 as the plates were spreading up to 8-9 meters. And when I turn the camera to the north from Krafla, we can see why it's called a rifting episode. And that remarkable event turned out to be a university for scientists in order to understand the theory of continental drift. And the Kópasker earthquake turned out to be one of the highlights. And there is a small earthquake center in town to commemorate that event and of course to have something for tourists. And in fact, a part of the plate boundaries that we call the Tjörnes Fracture Zone has enough built-up tension to produce an earthquake up to magnitude 7. It will most likely occur offshore, and I'm leaving a link to a recent video I made about that. But now, in September 2022, over 10,000 earthquakes have been detected during the past 2 weeks by the island Grímsey out there. So this is of course not over, and never will be. And when I place myself on the sandy coast created by numerous floods from a glacial river throughout the centuries and look over the fjord to Kópasker, we have this lake, and it wasn't here before the last drifting event. This is simply a ground depression from some of the movements back then that gradually filled up with water, and today it is a popular and a good fishing lake. And wherever we look around on aerial photos, we can see a sample of those forces that are pulling the country apart little by little. But as for other kind of geological events, the town is not situated in a region with volcanic activity, at least not during the past few hundred years. But the mountain ridge behind the town is however a good reminder about where we are, or by the plate boundaries, where we should say never. And I have to mention that in 1823, a strange event occurred just north from the town in this mountain pass. Allegedly, it was a small eruption, or at least an explosion. So we had a crater there for a while, or until it was discovered as extra good gravel to make roads. But luckily, it was after some German scientists got a chance to do some research there in 1911. But even so, that eruption or explosion remains a certain mystery still today. Once again, telling us that we only understand so much. And that's what makes this land so exciting. Full of mysteries and half-told stories that might never be explained fully. And Kópasker is literally a plate boundary village. And why do people choose to live here, might one ask, with the earthquake risk and such? But rural and peaceful are the words that come to my mind first. And I have the feeling that this village will survive, even grow a bit, since new jobs will be generated with the new onshore fish farm. But I'm not seeing them go after the tourists, at least not yet. And it is not necessary to make all towns into some kind of tourist display. For me, it's just enough to drive through and find an open door to get myself a cup of coffee. And I believe that quite many tourists do actually appreciate that this place is just how it is. What you see is what you get. And with that, I'm sending you best regards from Iceland and feel free to subscribe as I'm just starting this long tour.